Sammy the Bull Gravano was the mob's perfect killer. No questions, no mistakes, no guilt.
Here's a man that went to bed with a woman every night of his married life, knowing that he murdered her brother.
He said he felt like he could feel the bullet leaving the gun. To take a man's life didn't repel him.
He built a construction empire in New York City and became underboss to John Gotti, the infamous Dapper Don.
Sammy Gravano was the power behind the throne.
When the feds closed in, Gravano made a decision that would put his boss behind bars for life and decimate New York's most powerful crime family.
As a member of our family's administration, I helped John Gotti run the family. Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. My name is Salvatore Gravano. Early in my life, I was given the nickname Sammy the Bull.
In a working-class neighborhood of Brooklyn called Bensonhurst, people would whisper about the mafia, about men who were connected. Sammy Gravano, the highest-ranking mobster ever to testify against his boss, was born here on March 12, 1945. Young Sammy grew up in this house with his parents and two older sisters. He kept pictures of James Cagney and Humphrey Bogart on the walls of his room. His parents were Sicilian immigrants who ran a small dress factory. On their way to Sunday Mass, Sammy and his father would pass a corner saloon where gangsters congregated.
He noticed his father always walked on the other side of the street. And Sammy wondered, he kept saying, who are these people? Who are those men, Dad? And finally, his father said, well, they're bad people. But they're our bad people.
It was these men who gave Sammy his nickname. He had just turned 10, and someone had stolen the bicycle his parents had given him for his birthday. Gravano spotted two older boys with his bike across the street from the saloon. He ran over and tried to slug it out with both of them. A mafioso stepped in and gave Sammy his bike back.
And as the mafioso walks back across the street, he yells to the other guys hanging out there, do you see this little Sammy? He's like a little bull. And that's how he got the name, Sammy the Bull.
While Gravano earned the admiration of mobsters, he was not winning compliments from his school teachers. At Shallow Junior High, he was held back twice. Sammy's parents were told their son was a slow learner. He was, in fact, dyslexic.
He started beating up some of the boys in the class who had been mocking him. And as he said, they stopped all the laughing. He said, that was the first time I found out violence paid.
One day when he was about 13 years old, Sammy got drunk and ended up in the principal's office. As the principal was lecturing him, Sammy stood up and punched the man, breaking his jaw. Gravano was expelled and eventually ended up in a school for juvenile delinquents. Sammy would occasionally lend a hand at his parents' dress factory. It was there he got another look at the mafia. Two union thugs appeared one day and tried to extort his father for using non-union labor. They vowed to return the next week to collect. Sammy got a hold of a gun and was ready to use it to protect his father. But when the two thugs showed up again, Sammy's father wielded a more powerful weapon.
His father mentioned the name of a guy he knew from the old country, a gangster named Sebilo, and all of a sudden, the two guys changed their tune immediately. They knew right away that Sammy's old man was not a guy to fool around with because he knew somebody in the mob. At that point, Sammy realized the power that gangsters had.
Sammy's father had shown he was not above calling on that power himself. But he tried to keep his son from choosing the life of a gangster. He had struggled to provide a comfortable lifestyle for his family. There was a car and even a Long Island summer cottage. But Sammy saw a shortcut to wealth and acceptance.
Sammy Gravano, growing up, looked at his father and said, "That looks too hard. You know, I'm looking around, I'm seeing the American dreams, I'm seeing big cars and wads of money and people who don't really seem to have to work for it. I want to be one of those guys.
By the time he was 16, he had dropped out of school and was committing burglaries and stealing cars with a Bensonhurst street gang known as the Rampers. Sammy and his friends in the gang took an oath. They would stick together forever. But Gravano was forced to leave his gang behind in 1964. He was drafted into the army and sent off to Fort Jackson, South Carolina for basic training. Sammy was small, just 5 feet 5 inches, but he made up for it in toughness. To his surprise, the 19-year-old grew to like being a soldier, the rules and traditions, the hierarchy. Gravano attained the rank of corporal just as the war in Vietnam was heating up.
He said, "You wouldn't mind staying in the army and going to Vietnam." He said, "They gave medals to you for killing people."
But Sammy was never sent overseas. And when his 2-year hitch was over, he left the army, returned to Bensonhurst, and fell back in with the Rampers. In 1968, a fellow gang member introduced the Bull to his uncle, Tommy Shorty Spiro. Shorty was an associate in New York's Colombo crime family. He recruited Sammy into his crew of burglars. Gravano was 25 when Shorty ordered him to kill another crew member named Joseph Colucci. It was his first murder assignment. The reason behind the killing had to do with Colucci's wife. Shorty's nephew was having an affair with her and wanted to marry her. For Sammy, the reason hardly mattered, nor that Colucci was a friend of his. Carrying out the first hit, what mobsters call making your bones, was a vital step in becoming a member or made guy in the mafia.
He believed in the Cosa Nostra principles. And the principles are, when the boss tells you somebody has to go, he goes.
Colucci was riding in the front seat of a 64 Riviera on February 28, 1970, after a night of club hopping. Sammy the Bull sat right behind him. Gravano pulled out a .32 caliber pistol and shot Colucci twice in the back of the head.
He said he felt like he could feel the bullet leaving the gun. And to take a man's life didn't repel him. It gave him a sense of importance and power that he was now in a position where, sanctioned by some secret society, he could be the instrument that caused someone to live or die.
Jackie Colucci learned of her brother's death the next morning.
Sammy and all the crowd, all the boys came in and started crying and hugging us and saying, "We're going to find out who did this to Joey. Don't worry. You know, we'll find out what happened."
Sammy had made his bones and was on his way to becoming a made guy. His stock in the Colombo crime family soared. That is, until he started feuding with Shorty's brother. Shorty settled the matter by arranging for the Bull to get a mafia transfer. He left the Colombo family and joined another one, the Gambinos, then the most powerful in New York City. By now, Gravano had started a family of his own. When Sammy met 17-year-old Deborah Shibetta, her innocence caught his attention. They married less than a year later, in April 1971. Sammy would later say they were like wolves who mate and stay together for good. Deborah understood the world she was entering. An uncle was a mob captain.
She was strong-minded, she was not flashy, she was good-looking. And she loved Sammy, and Sammy loved her.
The couple had a daughter, Karen, and later a son, Gerard. The biggest day of Sammy's life, however, was neither his wedding nor the birth of his children. It came in 1976, when Gambino crime boss Paul Castellano inducted Sammy the Bull Gravano into La Cosa Nostra. Castellano kissed the 31-year-old gangster on both cheeks. He decreed, "I am the boss. I am the father of the family. I am your God." In less than a decade, Sammy would betray that oath, joining a plot to murder the father of the family. A plot masterminded by a man to whose fate Gravano would forever be linked, John Gotti.
I became a made member of the Gambino family in 1976. At that time, Paul Castellano was the boss of the Gambino family. John Gotti, I, along with some others, murdered Paul Castellano. We took over the family.
Sammy the Bull Gravano met the man who would one day become his crime boss, John Gotti, at an after-hours club in Bensonhurst in 1978. The two gangsters were complete opposites. Gotti was flashy and loved the New York nightlife. Gravano was low-key and enjoyed playing chess, a game perfectly suited to his competitive nature and his obsession with rules and hierarchy. The two men sized each other up.
Each of them knew of the other. Each of them had a reputation in their own neighborhoods. And each of them filed away the introduction. And it was kind of a mutual admiration society for a long time between John Gotti and Sammy Gravano.
Gotti was an unofficial mob captain, busy hijacking cargo at JFK Airport. Sammy was just making his mark in a racket that required more intelligence, one that would make him a rich man. Construction. Gravano had started by taking over a drywall company and opening a plumbing company. When boss Paul Castellano had water pressure problems at his Staten Island mansion, Sammy did the boss a favor and sent his workers over to fix it. Sammy impressed Castellano. They began meeting one-on-one. The Bull saw in his crime boss a fellow businessman, someone who could help him get to the top.
Castellano, in Sammy's view, was the best thing since sliced bread, an intelligent, smart guy. Sammy would go and see him, and he'd be sitting there in his silk gown reading the Wall Street Journal.
Big Paul and the Gambino family controlled several labor unions in the construction business. If a contractor wanted to avoid work slowdowns or use cheaper non-union labor, he had to do business with companies owned or controlled by the mob. In return for a sizable chunk of the profits, the mob boss gave Sammy his blessing and put the unions behind him. By the early 1980s, Gravano was flourishing.
We had like two companies in the beginning, and then as time went on, there were two or three, four companies added on. That, you know, it was that's when I started saying to myself, me, this guy's opening up a lot of different companies here. You know, something must be expanding his horizons.
Gravano was known as a shrewd businessman who did good work. But people who called on Sammy's influence and went into business with him sometimes found they got more than they bargained for.
What they probably didn't all count on was that over time, Gravano would be more than lending a hand, that he would be taking over their business and that they would be out, and in some cases later they would be dead. But that is the way the world of organized crime works. It is all about the threat of force, then the use of force, and ultimately murder to achieve one goal, which is to make money.
The Bull was not only earning a reputation as a big money maker for the Gambino crime family, the boss knew he could also count on Sammy as a killer. In 1980, boss Castellano ordered the murder of a Philadelphia capo named Johnny Keyes Simone. This time, Gravano was not the trigger man. Sammy formed his own crews now to carry out mob executions that he planned.
He says, you don't have to be a genius to pull the trigger. That's the easiest part of a hit. It's setting it up, it's making sure it's done.
In his rise up the mafia ladder, Sammy would not let anyone stand in his way, not even members of his own family. Sammy's brother-in-law, Nick Shibetta, was a low-level crime associate whose cocaine and alcohol problems, along with his homosexuality, had become an embarrassment in the underworld. There were fears he might become an informant. Gravano asked the boss for permission to kill his brother-in-law. Big Paul approved the hit. Gravano's crew murdered Shibetta, and in a sign of disrespect, carved him into pieces. A hand was discovered and buried in a coffin. Sammy comforted his wife during her brother's funeral in 1981. Deborah Gravano had no idea her husband was behind Nick's murder.
Here's a man that went to bed with a woman every night of his married life, knowing that he murdered her brother. Not a lot of men can say that.
Like other gangsters, Gravano had an ability to separate his mob world from his family life when he returned to his Staten Island home every evening.
He had to work hard to bring those kids up. And it is ironic that you can paint the picture of a Fred McMurray home life, the wife, the kids, the loving family, and then you go out every day and you decide who to murder.
Sammy spent weekends with his family at a 30-acre estate in rural New Jersey that he had acquired from a building contractor who owed him money. There was a horse breeding farm and a racetrack. After years of robbing, stealing, and killing, Gravano finally had a home to rival his boss's mansion. He had made it. With his success, however, came growing resentment at Paul Castellano. Like other gangsters in the crime family, Sammy felt that Castellano, who had become boss through his family connection to his predecessor, Carlo Gambino, had never paid his dues on the street. Such pretensions could be tolerated, but not Big Paul's ravenous appetite for the crime family's earnings. Castellano was already taking a big slice of Sammy's and every other gangster's earnings, but the boss was going too far. In 1984, he formed a construction company and made the head of the rival Genovese crime family, Vincent the Chin Gigante, his partner. Gravano and the rest of the Gambino soldiers were left out of most of the contracts. Big Paul even allowed Gigante to murder a Gambino captain. In Sammy's eyes, this was unforgivable, a transgression against the code of the underworld.
We have a code, an oath, an honor. And I think over time he found there's no real code. The oath is broken immediately, from the first day, by everyone. And there's no real honor.
The resentment against the boss was transforming into a rebellion, led by a man Sammy had met 7 years earlier in a Brooklyn bar, John Gotti. In 1985, Gotti plotted to kill the crime boss. He wanted the bull with him. Gravano hesitated before giving an answer. Castellano was the father of the family. He had groomed Sammy. But John Gotti offered something Paul Castellano never would. Power within the crime family. And power meant the opportunity to make even more money. Gravano's pragmatism overcame his sense of loyalty.
Every time he saw an opportunity, particularly in business, if that meant killing somebody, he killed somebody. If it meant taking over somebody's business, a bar, a restaurant, he took it over. He saw another opportunity for Sammy Gravano, and he took it.
On December 16th, 1985, four shooters waited for Paul Castellano to arrive at Spark Steakhouse on 2nd Avenue and 46th Street in Manhattan. Just a block away, Sammy Gravano sat next to John Gotti in a parked Lincoln. If the shooters somehow failed, the bull was ready with a .357 Magnum to finish the job.
There was a bond of trust that started that night, which is, we're knee-deep in this thing, and if this thing backfires, we're both dead.
Castellano and his driver, Tommy Bellotti, pulled in front of Sparks at 5 o'clock. Seconds later, gunshots erupted. Gotti and Gravano cruised past the restaurant where Bellotti and Castellano lay in pools of blood. Gotti was now head of the Gambinos. He made Gravano a captain. As the two men celebrated a new era in the Gambino crime family, Sammy had no idea how quickly it would crumble, nor that he would become the instrument of its demise.
As a member of our family's administration, I helped John Gotti run the family. My primary responsibility was controlling the construction industry in New York. I did this by working.
Sammy the Bull Gravano was a mere soldier in the Gambino crime family when he helped arrange the murder of boss Big Paul Castellano in December 1985. Just 5 months later, the 41-year-old would get his first taste of underworld leadership. In May 1986, the new boss, John Gotti, turned himself in to face federal racketeering charges. Gotti looked for the best man on the street to lead the Gambinos in his absence. He chose Gravano. Gotti knew he could count on the Bull to keep the family in line while he called the shots from his Manhattan jail cell. One of Gotti's first steps was to order Sammy to murder a Gambino soldier named Robert D.B. DiBernardo for talking behind the boss's back. Gravano murdered DiBernardo at the Bull's Bensonhurst office on Stillwell Avenue. D.B. had overseen the Teamsters Union local that delivered materials to building job sites. It was a key to the Gambino's construction rackets, and now Sammy controlled it.
Killing, in Gravano's eyes, was part of policing the mob to make sure that these people towed the line, said the right things, and didn't violate the rules. That's what he said. But from the greed standpoint, every time Gravano killed someone for one of these infractions, he got that much richer.
Gravano did more than kill for his new boss. He got him out of jail. The Bull had discovered the jury foreman could be bribed for $120,000. Sammy haggled him down to $60,000. Gotti was acquitted. Gravano had impressed Gotti so much that a year later, in 1988, he made Sammy his number three man, or consigliere. Since Gotti didn't know much about the construction rackets, he entrusted Sammy to handle them. The Bull had an unnerving presence that helped him enforce the Gambino family's interests.
He had these eyes that I always call them like wolf's eyes, where they could turn on you. And a big part of his role is intimidation and extortion to make all these companies play ball, and Sammy was very good at that.
Among the victims of Gravano's wrath was a member of his own crew, Michael DeBat. When DeBat got hooked on cocaine, Sammy decided he could no longer be trusted. One of the Bull's crew members put six bullets in DeBat's head and neck. Gravano told DeBat's sister, Roseanne Massa, who had once been his secretary, that he had nothing to do with the murder.
Sammy came to my brother's wake and gave us $500, that should have comforted us. And we took that $500, burnt it up in the ashtray, and told my brother to rest in peace.
Sammy's ruthlessness was taking him to the pinnacle of the Gambino family. A squad of FBI agents was now paying close attention to Gravano, something the Bull was tipped off about by the teenagers he played handball with near his Bensonhurst office. By now, Sammy's family had moved to this more upscale Staten Island home. Agents knew Gravano rarely strayed from his morning routine. By 7:30, he was on his way to Gleason's gym in Brooklyn. Teddy Atlas, who had once honed the skills of a Brooklyn teenager named Mike Tyson, trained his fighters there. Atlas occasionally worked out with Gravano and put him through his paces.
He heard me say that a fighter, most important thing a fighter has to do is control his fear. He was surprised. He said, "Fighters have fear?" I said, "Everyone has fear." He said, "Well, I don't." And I do remember making a conscious thought to myself, he's lying.
Atlas sent his professional fighters to a hypnotist to reinforce their training. Sammy asked for an appointment.
He told me he was a white-collar worker. He wanted to take off weight. He actually said he wanted to stop eating cake and candy and ice cream. I would talk to him about how he was going to be the better boxer.
Trainer Atlas claims Sammy tried getting an edge another way: steroids. Atlas concluded Gravano was not in the gym simply for a good workout.
I felt that he was doing the boxing and doing the steroids to give himself confidence that he couldn't find himself, to build himself up, to bulk himself up, not physically only, but mentally. to face certain things, to be less afraid.
Gravano's boss had given him reason to be anxious. John Gotti had begun holding court at the Ravenite Social Club in Little Italy, which was just a few minutes from FBI headquarters. Gotti made his top leaders check in every afternoon.
John Gotti would show up there with his $2,000 suit and his $200 tie and his entourage and his luxury car. Sam would show up in his work clothes or blue jeans. End of the night, say 8:30, 9 o'clock, Gotti would leave with his entourage to go out partying. Sammy would leave there, he'd go home and spend the night with his family.
Gravano tried to warn his crime boss that the Ravenite was no place for the mob to conduct business. The media and even the public were showing up. Gotti didn't listen. Instead, he basked in the attention while his consigliere fumed.
He knew that that light for John Gotti was like a moth to a flame, that you could circle it and bask in it for only so long before you got burned and killed.
Sammy's anxieties were warranted. In November 1989, the FBI had planted a bug in an apartment above the Ravenite where John Gotti held his most private conversations. Agents were steadily building a murder and racketeering case against the Gambino family's upper echelon. In January 1990, the FBI overheard Gotti give a big promotion to the Bull.
You want to sell this book here? Or you want me to make you official under the boss? At the boss? How do you feel? What makes you feel better?
Gravano became official underboss of the Gambino crime family. But with the FBI watching the family's every move, the Bull could hardly enjoy his new position. He feared he was about to be indicted.
He just came in the gym where we trained one day and he said, imagine that the U.S. government's gonna be coming after me. They conquer countries, they start wars, and they're coming after little old him. That could make you shake in your boots.
If he wound up in prison, Sammy worried about his teenage son, Gerard. While John Gotti had made his son a mafia captain, Sammy did not want his boy anywhere near the underworld.
He had asked me, would I take care of the kid? Would I train him? I understood that that meant that he was concerned about the kid.
Atlas would keep his word when Sammy's fears of going to jail became a reality. On December 11th, 1990, the FBI arrested Gravano, Gotti, and consigliere Frank Locascio. They were locked up in the Metropolitan Correctional Center. It was there that Gravano would make the most important decision of his life, turning his back on La Cosa Nostra and testifying against his boss, John Gotti.
I began to cooperate with the government in 1991. I decided to cooperate before we, meaning me, John Gotti, and our acting consigliere, Frank Locascio, went to trial.
The moment of truth for Sammy the Bull Gravano and his crime boss John Gotti came on December 21st, 1990. The two mobsters were in court, along with co-defendant Frank Locascio, for a bail hearing. They had been accused of murder and racketeering. Prosecutors played undercover tapes the FBI had recorded in Gotti's headquarters in Little Italy. Gravano had been passing along over $1 million a year to his boss, but Gotti was heard complaining that the Bull was getting greedy. Gravano listened as Gotti admitted to approving several murders, including that of Robert D.B. DiBernardo, and blamed Sammy for instigating those murders. In all, John Gotti had pinned three murders on his underboss.
For one of the few times in life, John Gotti was actually embarrassed. He wanted to dive under the table. Sammy turned white and then red. He was just furious.
The judge denied bail. Sammy, his boss, and Frank Locascio were each locked up in separate jail cells in the isolation unit of New York's Metropolitan Correctional Center. Sammy, a creature of habit who rarely strayed from his daily routine, was back in jail for the first time in 17 years.
Unlike Gotti, you know, he had never really done a stretch of, you know, 2 years here or 5 years there. I think jail was strange and frightening to him.
Locked in his cell, 23 hours a day, the bull lay on his cot and brooded over Gotti's betrayal. When they were finally released from the isolation unit after a month, Gotti invited his underboss to a man-to-man discussion.
John basically told Sammy, "I was just talking, Sammy. What are you worried about? What's the big deal?" And Sammy said, "Hey, you were talking about me behind my back. That's not the way things are supposed to run."
The bull looked at the pieces on the chessboard and decided that the boss was setting him up as a pawn that could be sacrificed. Sammy was 46 years old, and if convicted, was likely to spend the rest of his life in prison.
I think when he looked at his options then, he said, you know, life in here is not an option, not for any code of honor.
After nearly 10 months in jail, Sammy reached a fateful decision, one that would not only change his life forever, but would turn the New York underworld upside down. Gravano, the second highest ranking member of the most powerful crime family in America, would testify for the government. He would become the thing he had always hated, a rat. Sammy sent a message to the FBI. 2 weeks later, he met secretly with agents and a prosecutor in the jury room of the courthouse about cutting a deal.
This was the underboss of the family, the man who was used to communicate with all the other families, the man who knew all of the other bosses and underbosses and captains. This was the mother lode.
When his wife Deborah and daughter Karen came to visit him in jail, Sammy told them about his deal with the government. Karen, shocked that her father was becoming a snitch, fled the room crying. Deborah stayed behind as her husband explained.
He told her what he was going to do. Testify against Gotti and go into the witness protection program. And she wouldn't do it. She said, you know, I can't put my children through it and me. I think she said, that part of our life is your life, it's not mine.
Deborah left the jail and for the time being left her husband as well. At midnight on November 8th, Sammy also walked out of the jail, leaving John Gotti and the mob behind forever.
John Gotti sent a message to the effect that part of my heart broke when my son was killed. The other part broke when you defected to the government.
The bull was transferred to the FBI's training academy in Quantico, Virginia, where a deal was finalized. Gravano agreed to testify for 2 years in any case the government wanted. The most prison time he could get was 20 years. Back in New York, when word got out that Sammy had become a government witness, flyers were posted all over the city showing Sammy's head on the body of a rat.
There are times where he had pangs about cooperating. He had a lot of guilt for what he was doing, a lot of remorse. And he always had this constant fear of being abandoned by the government.
On March 2nd, 1992, Gravano became the highest ranking member of La Cosa Nostra ever to testify against his boss. As he settled into his chair, Sammy ignored Gotti's stare. The jury listened as prosecutors led Gravano through a blow-by-blow account of his life in the mob and the murder of Gambino crime boss Paul Castellano.
They believed him. They didn't like him. They didn't like him at all. He's not a likable guy in a lot of ways. Well, in all ways, frankly. But they believed him.
Gotti's attorney, Albert Krieger, cross-examined Gravano. The bull stood his ground.
He was contained, articulate, not responsive as the angry, blustering degenerate I now know him to be.
"I was a good, loyal soldier," Sammy announced near the end of his 9-day testimony. "John barked, and I bit." On April 2nd, 1992, The jury found Gotti guilty of all murder and racketeering charges.
Gravano's attitude was Gotti tried to betray him, and Sammy took steps to see that that didn't happen. Like it was a chess game. Except Gotti was playing with checkers.
Gotti was sentenced to life in prison without parole at the U.S. Penitentiary in Marion, Illinois. Gravano, on the other hand, was about to become a free man. After helping to put his crime boss, John Gotti, in prison for life in 1992, Sammy Gravano spent the next 2 years testifying for the government. He became the most famous mob turncoat since Joe Valachi. Like Valachi, Gravano testified before a U.S. Senate hearing on organized crime. This one focused on the mob's corruption of professional boxing, including its practice of paying off fighters to throw bouts.
And I believe if he would have knocked them out by accident, he would have picked them up.
By the time he finished testifying, Gravano played a role in sending 37 people to prison. They included a juror, a cop, several union officials, four crime family bosses, nine captains, and over 30 mob soldiers.
You never got guilty pleas from these characters before. You point Sammy at them and they give up because they know Sammy knows. Sammy was their boss.
Gravano's own sentencing came on September 26, 1994. The bull faced up to 20 years in prison. Before sentencing Sammy, Judge Leo Glasser declared, "There has never been a defendant whose impact on organized crime has been so important and so extensive." Judge Glasser sentenced the bull to 5 years in prison, plus 3 years of supervised release. With time already served, Gravano had less than 7 months left in prison. To Gotti's defense attorney, the sentence was a blot on the justice system.
Gravano is filth to his core. What he has done is he has found a way to bargain for his freedom, and we buy it.
The 37 people who were convicted and in jail because Sammy Gravano testified would be on the street, themselves killing people still, if we didn't reward testimony of accomplice witnesses.
Gravano walked out of a federal prison for government witnesses on April 19, 1995, a free man of sorts. John Gotti had allegedly put a $2 million bounty on his head. He had just turned 50 years old and was about to be reborn in the Witness Protection Program. Before assigning him a new identity, the government did a psychological evaluation of Gravano. The conclusion was hardly reassuring. The likelihood of violent behavior is substantial, the report noted. He continues to be violent despite his age.
Let's say he opened a video store. And, you know, a guy opened a video store across the street from him. And he'd say, "Hey, you know, it's a small town. Why don't you open a video store somewhere else?" In his old life, he'd firebomb the guy's store. If he reopened, he'd kill him. Now he can't do that. And the question is, you know, can he adjust? Has he adjusted?
As the bull tried to start a new life with a new identity, he showed he was anything but predictable. He had always hugged the shadows as a gangster. But rather than sink safely into anonymity, Gravano soon dropped out of witness protection and thrust himself back into the public eye. In a best-selling book written with Peter Maas, and in a television interview with Diane Sawyer, Sammy appeared without a disguise, giving the country a good look at his plastic surgery. Just as his crime boss once had, Gravano now seemed to crave the spotlight. By exposing himself, he inadvertently opened the legal doors to a group of people who were as eager to hunt him down as John Gotti, the relatives of the bull's 19 murder victims. The book allowed them to file wrongful death claims against Gravano under New York's Son of Sam law. Roseanne Massa's brother Mike DeBatt was one of Sammy's victims, most of whom were associated in some way with the mob.
Nobody's proclaiming anybody to be an altar boy. But before these men sold their souls, they were somebody's father, somebody's brother, somebody's son, and their lives had meaning to people.
It's good for Sammy Gravano to know that he can't entirely wrap himself up in the American flag, because out there are people who, under color of law, are seeking to recover the money that he's made from the murders that he committed.
When Gravano returned to the stand in 1997 to testify against Genovese crime boss Vincent the Chin Gigante, the families of the Bulls murder victims converged on the courthouse.
What's Gravano doing here? Selling more books.
During cross-examination, Gigante's defense attorney forced Gravano to admit that he hoped to make nearly $1.5 million from his book and a related movie deal. Gigante was convicted. The wrongful death suits are still pending.
So many lives were touched by the actions of this one man. That this one man, look what he's done to his own family. I think about his son and his daughter. You imagine the weight of the world on his son's shoulders? I think about this kid. His daughter. What happens the day she gets married? Sammy gonna walk her down the aisle?
Deborah Gravano sold their Staten Island home and moved to another state with daughter Karen and son Gerard. She and Sammy have divorced. Though he occasionally calls to check up on their children, Deborah now knows for certain that Sammy was responsible for killing her brother.
He said the thought of putting his loyalty to Cousin Oscar above his loyalty to his wife and his children was something he was going to have to live with for the rest of his life.
Since Gravano is no longer in the witness protection program, he must fend for himself against those who would like to see him dead. Of course, many of those people are now behind bars. But there's always a young Turk looking to become a made man, just as Sammy once did.
He said he couldn't discount the thought that some kid would try to make a name for himself by taking him out. And he looked away in the distance as if he were seeing this kid approaching. He looked back at me and said, "Boy, he better be good."
The Bull has once again disappeared into the shadows.
The thing that makes him unique is that he turned at the top of his game and helped bring down 30 to 40 guys in and around the Gambino crime family.
It amazes me how many different hats this man wore. He wore the hat of a businessman, of a father, of a husband, of a murderer, of an extortionist.
He's trying to go on with his life. You know, he's had to step over a few bodies to do it. But I think he's trying to go on with his life.
He's just a regular old rat. He's the kind of guy who is in it for Sammy Gravano, and he has no loyalty to anyone except Sammy Gravano.